I cannot think of another investigation that has generated this level of media and public interest.
Shortly after 8 o'clock this morning, 49-year-old Erin Patterson was arrested at her home in the small town of Leongatha in Victoria's East.
Today's arrest is just the next step in what has been a complex and thorough investigation, and one that is not yet over.
Detectives now scouring Erin's home using technology detector dogs trained to smell chemicals found on SIM cards and hard drives, hoping to find answers to the mystery of how a quiet family lunch turned to tragedy.
I didn't do anything. I loved them.
In late July, Erin Patterson cooked up a beef Wellington pie for four guests: her former in-laws, Don and Gail Patterson, Gail's sister, Heather Wilkinson, and Heather's husband, Ian. Only Ian, after spending almost 2 months in hospital, survived. The meal, alleged to have contained deadly death cat mushrooms.
I'm devastated. I love them. And I can't believe that this has happened, and I'm so sorry that they have lost their lives.
I just can't believe it.
Erin has always maintained she didn't intentionally poison the family, saying she bought the mushrooms at an Asian grocery store but can't recall which one.
Can you tell us where the mushrooms came from?
Forensic testing on Erin's food dehydrator, found by police at the local tip, forming part of their investigation. Erin says she dumped it in a panic, afraid she would lose custody of her kids after her ex-husband Simon asked her if it was what you used to poison them.
Erin, how are you going?
I'm going, this for asking. You guys aren't helping.
Erin today being questioned by police as the tight-knit town of Leongatha is thrust back into the spotlight.
It's the story that has gripped Australia.
Police have taken the cook into custody.
Police are trying to determine if the deaths were homicide.
It's particularly important that we keep in mind that at the heart of this, three people have lost their lives. These are three people who were much beloved in their communities and are greatly missed by their loved ones.
John Sylvester is the author of Naked City, which is a collection of some of Australia's best crime stories. He's been covering those stories over 40 years of reporting, so you better believe he's been following this particular case. John, what questions do you think police will be asking of Erin Patterson?
Well, she's given a version of events, but they'll certainly be trying to find out where the death cat mushrooms came from, what food was used to ingest it, why her food dehydrator was dumped the day after, what was the purpose of the lunch, why didn't she get ill when everybody else did. So they're just a few of the questions to begin with.
She also fed her children the leftovers from the meal, is that right? That's a pretty important question I'm sure police will put to her.
Her version of events is that the day after she had some remaining beef Wellington, which was the main course, and she served it to her children. Now, as a matter of logic, forget about sinister behaviour. If you had served food to some people and they got profoundly ill, the first thing you would do is empty your fridge. You wouldn't be serving any of that food to anybody, let alone your own kids. So it is entirely logical to believe that she knew that, at least in that beef Wellington, there was no poison.
Why are the police only searching her house now? Because it's been months.
This is a very, very specific search. They are using Australia Federal Police dogs. These dogs are amazing, specifically trained to find technology. They can find and have found such things as a SIM card in a bowl of garlic. So it is fair to say that those dogs are there to try and find something like a SIM card, a mobile phone, a laptop. And that it's a very, very specific search.
John, you keep referring to her version of events. I imagine you're talking about things like, you know, the press... Well, I was going to say press conference. It wasn't that. She was stopped. But those sort of statements that have been made to the media, none of those were sworn. None of those were, like, official police interviews or whatever. Could she now offer a completely different story and that doesn't affect her case necessarily because now she's actually answering questions from police? Or is she bound by what she said before?
Not at all. She certainly can answer police questions. as frankly as she wants to. What happened was she, when she was first questioned by police, she took, under legal advice, her rights to give effectively a no-comment record of interview. Then she sacked her lawyer and she got another lawyer, where she made a statement to the lawyer with a version of events, which was handed to police and to the media. This is the version where she says she bought dried mushrooms from an Asian grocer. She said she bought mushrooms from the local supermarket and she combined them in the Beef Wellington dish. The big breakthrough, I think, is one of the victims survived. This was a case that was going to take a long time, but, and certainly the police were of the view that they were going to be looking at four deaths. But one of the people has made a recovery of sorts and has spoken to police. What that person said, I don't know, but it certainly will be something that will have improved the investigation.
Extraordinary, John. It's great to have someone of your experience and knowledge to speak to about something like this. We appreciate your time.
Good on you. Thanks very much.
Dr. Xanthi Mallett is a criminologist at the University of Newcastle and she's here with us to unpack the case. Xanthi, it's been 3 months since this story first came to light. What would have been happening behind the scenes in that time?
So we have to remember this is a multi-death investigation, so there would have been a number of avenues of inquiry the police would have been following. They would have been collecting all of the physical evidence, so they were obviously looking at any spores that may have been in that dehydrator that was sent off internationally for analysis to see whether the mushrooms had come from there. They also would have been speaking to friends and neighbours, building a picture of what was going on, and obviously, they had to wait until the survivor was well enough to be interviewed. So whilst it may feel like this has taken a long time, actually 3 months an investigation of this type is actually nothing. And I'm expecting it to continue as we find out more of what happened at that lunch.
There are also things that I found quite a revelation, like these super sleuth technology detector dogs. What kind of evidence would they be hoping to find, like in an old SIM card or a hard drive?
Well, that's the interesting question, isn't it? I've known of a lot of different detection dogs. You know, we have cadaver dogs, we have search and rescue dogs, we have dogs that look for money and drugs. But obviously they have intelligence because those are not the type of dogs you would take to a scene without having a very good reason. And they've had 3 months to really plan this search. So obviously they think something may have been hidden on a SIM card and then disposed of potentially outside because these dogs were showing a lot of interest outside of the property.
I'm just thinking, though, if I had information on a technological device that might be incriminating, I reckon in 3 months it wouldn't be there anymore. Like, you know, you just figure out a way of disposing it. Is it really going to yield anything to send them in now?
I would say, separate to this case, that, you know, people leave all sorts of evidence behind that you may think over those months, you know, they may have removed. So, you know, it is possible that things will still be recovered. Certainly the police think there may be evidence in this case, and that will come to light in the weeks and months going forward.
Well, the police are questioning her right now. If they've already interviewed her, what else would they be hoping to find?
Well, remember, they originally interviewed her quite early on in this piece. So since then, they've been collecting all of that other information. So since they've gathered that, they will want to re-interview her in light of the rest of the information they have collected to see whether they can really piece together what happened. Because originally, she was the only witness to this lunch until they could interview the one survivor. So they've been piecing it together in the meantime. So they've got a lot more questions for her at this stage, and they really want her to corroborate her earlier statements or explain some of those questions. You know, where did those mushrooms in fact come from? Were they bought from an Asian supermarket, for example, and if so, where? So they still have lots of questions for her, and they'll be going over and over and over that with her today.
Fascinating investigation, and we'll be following it closely. Xanthi, thanks for your time.
Thank you.